silly story this week, so I thought I'd open with it. Story about a woman who went to a local psychic in hopes of contacting her dearly departed grandmother. Now, the psychic began by collecting her information, figuring out who she wanted to talk to, collected her money, and then they sat down together. The psychic went into some sort of trance for a minute or two and eventually came to with a voice and said, "Granddaughter, are you there?" The granddaughter, wide-eyed and excited, responded, "Grandmother, yes, I'm here. Is that you?" "Yes, granddaughter, it's me." "Is it really you, Grandma?" the woman asked. "Yes, it is me. It's me, your grandmother." And the woman paused a moment. "It's okay, grandmother. If it's you, I have a question for you." "Oh, yes, anything, my dear. Grandma, when did you learn to speak English?" This morning, we continue our series, Dangerous Terrain. What does that mean, again? What does that mean for those of you who maybe weren't here last week? Well, in our culture, in many, many cultures, many nations worldwide, the way they act and the things that we participate in don't necessarily match up to the way God calls us to live, the way the Bible explains that we need to seek holiness and righteousness. Essentially, our lives almost need to be countercultural in many different aspects. And since we're surrounded by so many influences, so many different things out there that can change our mindsets and our behavior, sometimes we find ourselves naturally just walking on dangerous terrain. This morning, as I introduced last week, we will explore the topics of the occult and the practices that come along with most of them. And now this is just going to be a broad overview and not tackle everything individually, but you'll hopefully walk away with an understanding and a belief system that shows that you need to avoid everything to do with the occult. And this will just include, if you don't understand what that means, this will just include things like psychics and horoscopes and astrology and things of that nature. That's what I mean when I say occult. But we'll cover it. You know, the Bible actually gives us an example of the occult and the dangers of it. And in 1 Samuel chapter 28, we'll read this morning about Saul's encounter with the occult. So if you want to turn along in your Bible to 1 Samuel chapter 28, you can. But as always, the verses will be on the screen. 1 Samuel 28, verses 5 through 11, says, "When Saul saw the army of the Philistines, he was afraid, and his heart trembled greatly. And when Saul inquired of the Lord did not answer him, either by dreams or by Urim or by prophets. Then Saul said to his servants, 'Seek out for me a woman who is a medium, that I may go to her and inquire of her.' And his servants said to him, 'Behold, there is a medium at Endor.' So Saul disguised himself and put on other garments and went, and two men with him. And they came to the woman by night, and he said, 'Divine for me by a spirit, and bring up for me whomever I shall name to you.' The woman said to him, 'Surely you know what Saul has done, how he has cut off the mediums and the necromancers from the land. Why then are you laying a trap for my life to bring about my death?' But Saul swore to her by the Lord, 'As the Lord lives, no punishment shall come upon you for this thing.' Then the woman said, 'Whom shall I bring up for you?' He said, 'Bring up Samuel for me.'" Here we see an unusual story of King Saul consulting a psychic, a medium. And what's so unusual about him doing such a thing is that really not too long before consulting this woman, he had declared that everyone who consulted women like this or people like this, mediums, psychics, necromancers, should be put to death upon doing so. In making this decree, King Saul was merely following God's command, which declared in Leviticus 20:27, a man or woman who is a medium or necromancer shall surely be put to death. They shall be stoned with stones, their blood shall be upon them. Before we focus further on Saul, and we're going to get back into the verses that follow what we read, we need to be reminded that this is occult activity that Saul is participating in. And God has always hated the occult. Over and over again throughout Scripture, God condemns these activities and these practices, this behavior. Fortune-telling, which include things like palm reading and horoscopes and tarot cards and things of that nature. Divination, which includes appealing to the spirit world, Ouija boards, tea leaves, things of that nature. And consulting the dead, which includes seances, visiting mediums, psychics, consulting people who are channelers, etc., etc. Now, just to remind you what we read last week in Deuteronomy 18:10-14, it says, there shall not be found among you anyone who burns his son or his daughter as an offering. Anyone who practices divination or tells fortunes or interprets omens or a sorcerer or a charmer or a medium or a necromancer or one who inquires of the dead. For whoever does these things is an abomination to the Lord. And because of these abominations, the Lord your God is driving them out before you. You shall be blameless before the Lord your God. For these nations which you're about to dispossess, listen to fortune tellers and to diviners. But as for you, the Lord your God has not allowed you to do this. God also declared in Leviticus chapter 20, this time verses 6 through 7, if a person turns to a medium and necromancers, whoring after them, I will set my face against that person and will cut him off from among his people. Consecrate yourselves, therefore, and be holy, for I am the Lord your God. Some of you might be thinking, and it was kind of brought to my attention last week, oh, this is all Old Testament stuff. This is Old Testament. So didn't Jesus fulfill it and then kind of rework it a little bit? Well, we're also told in the New Testament, in Revelation chapter 21, verse 8, NIV, but the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. So the occult is grouped in with that in the Old Testament and the New Testament. These practices, this behavior, it really cannot be taken lightly or just shrugged off as, oh, it's innocent. It's a serious subject matter with serious consequences. It's dangerous terrain. Now, there's a man by the name of Ben Alexander that I kind of researched a little bit this past week, who is an ex-spiritualist, a former medium, and he wrote a book called Out of Darkness. And after engaging in many occult behaviors throughout his early life up into his 30s, he found Christ. Or really, Christ rescued him. Now he travels about giving lectures on the dangers of Christians dabbling in the occult, dabbling in such practices. Alexander, in many of his lectures, explains that his time in the occult as having a fate worse than death. That's how serious he takes it. His rescue, his salvation in Christ changed his life completely. And Alexander, through his book and through his speaking engagements, wants to warn Christians of occult practices by sharing his firsthand experiences in his life. One point in his lecture that he would always make that seemed to take some people by surprise is that he would say, quote, the spirit realm is real. Because so many of us kind of just, okay, we read it in the Bible, we understand it, but we don't really take it as seriously as we should. But he had seen it, he had experienced it, and he knew that some of this activity was not all just smoke and mirrors. The spirit world really had nothing to do with talking to the dead, as many would claim, but rather had a lot to do with talking to demons and other forms of demonic activity. Now, from time to time, Alexander would be asked to debate, engage in debates with some mediums in a public forum. And during one of his debates, his opponent, who was a psychic, a medium, attempted to use the Bible against him. The medium actually referenced King Saul and his use of a medium, saying that, okay, well, the king of Israel engaged in it, therefore it's real. Therefore it works. Therefore it's condoned. And Alexander himself was extremely delighted that the medium chose to use the Bible against him, because now that the debate could be taken in the biblical direction. Alexander smiled and said, King Saul died because he went to a medium. The medium, the psychic who was debating with, was a little bit surprised, was a little bit shocked, and said, you know, I never read that in my Bible. So the moderator of the debate asked the medium for their Bible, and they didn't bring it with them. So Alexander happened to have his along with him. He said, can you just read a passage from 1 Chronicles for me? So the moderator read 1 Chronicles chapter 10, verses 13 through 14, which says, so Saul died for his breach of faith. He broke faith with the Lord in that he did not keep the command of the Lord, and also consulted a medium, seeking guidance. He did not seek guidance from the Lord, therefore the Lord put him to death and turned the kingdom over to David, the son of Jesse. Needless to say, the debate pretty much ended at that point. Taking a moment to look back at the scripture that we read in 1 Samuel 28 this morning, part of the reason that Saul was condemned was obviously first his attitude, his heart, what was going on within him, but also because of the fact that he sought out this medium, sought out this witch, this psychic. But it was also an issue of the heart, and that's where it starts. A lack of trust, a lack of faith in the Lord. Now, one of the other odd things about this account in 1 Samuel 28 is the fact that this medium, this witch, this psychic at Endor was surprised at what followed. Surprised that Samuel actually shows up on the scene. Let's read 1 Samuel 28, and we'll continue with verses 12 through 14. When the woman saw Samuel, she cried out with a loud voice, and the woman said to Saul, why have you deceived me? You are Saul. The king said to her, do not be afraid. What do you see? And the woman said to Saul, I see a God coming up out of the earth. And he said to her, what is his appearance? And she said, an old man is coming up, and he is wrapped in a robe. And Saul knew that it was Samuel, and he bowed with his face to the ground and paid homage. She was shocked. Why would a medium be shocked? First of all, when I read this, why didn't she know it was Saul? That's what I always think. But this time, she was shocked because things were different for her. She was no longer in control of this situation. Previous experience for this medium, we could assume, surely included deceptive, demonic forces. But this time, something more real was occurring in this event. You know, I'm sure we've all heard of Houdini, the famous magician, probably the most famous magician of all time, or at least debatable. Well, Houdini himself enjoyed visiting psychics, enjoyed visiting mediums. He liked to consult them to try to reconcile his feelings and his grief over family members who had passed died, so he'd want to talk with them. That's why he would seek them out. But Houdini, like I said, being probably the world's greatest magician, a master of deception, a master of trickery himself, would time after time, after consulting these mediums, expose them, see through the trickery, see through the sleight of hand, and expose them as frauds. And in our account, this witch, this psychic, this medium in 1 Samuel 28 was being exposed. Being exposed by God himself. This medium, this witch at Endor, had never actually talked to the dead before. And she couldn't have done so, because the Bible tells us multiple times, except for rare miracles, that once a person dies, they're gone. Hebrews 9:27 says, "And just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes judgment." There's no floating around, visiting relatives, visiting people they've left behind. When you're dead, you go to the place of judgment. Either way, Jesus told a story to explain this concept, and we know it as the rich man and Lazarus in Luke chapter 16. Both of these men die, and we come onto the scene with one being escorted to paradise and the other to Hades. Lazarus to paradise, the rich man to Hades. Hades, obviously a terrible place. So terrible that this rich man calls out to Abraham, begging him, please. Well, first he asks for water, but then secondly, please tell my brothers that this place is so terrible that they cannot come here. Warn them about this place. And we'll read that. Luke chapter 16, verses 26 through 31. "And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, in order that those who pass from here to you may not able, and none may cross from there to us. And he said, then I beg you, Father, to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they also come into this place of torment. But Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. He said to them, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead." The dead are not allowed to return, other than a couple miracles that we find in Scripture. And if they cannot return, whether one is dabbling in consulting the dead or not, what they're actually doing is dabbling in something much worse. Something in opposition to God. So you might ask, well, what's the problem? Really, come on. What's the problem with just playing a game, playing Ouija board at a party? What's the problem with that? Why would God be really upset if I just check my horoscope in the newspaper? What's the big deal with that? What's the big deal if I get a little palm reading when I'm on vacation or something, just as a joke? What's the harm in an innocent visit to a medium or a psychic? Is God really going to get mad? I mean, come on. Yeah. First and foremost, and most important, God just says not to. So why are we doing it? I'm going to read again from Deuteronomy 18, 12 through 14. "Whoever does these things is an abomination to the Lord. And because of these abominations, the Lord your God is driving them out before you. You shall be blameless before the Lord your God. For these nations which you are about to dispossess, listen to fortune tellers and diviners. But as for you, the Lord your God has not allowed you to do this." And that should be enough. That should be enough to keep us from doing things. But don't we all do things that we're not supposed to do? So don't get super hard on yourself for what you've done in the past. But seek holiness and righteousness from this point on, if this is something that you have dabbled in. But why else is it such a bad habit to fall into? Why is it really so bad? Well, the problem with Ouija boards, the problem with divination, horoscopes, psychics, mediums, astrology, is that Satan can simply use them to gain your affections and to manipulate decisions that you make in your life. Satan uses these tools of divination. What does that mean? That means things that will happen in your future, things that are to be foretold, to get us roped in because they sound intriguing, because they sound interesting, because they might give us a false sense of hope that we kind of want to hang on to get us to trust in something that is unfortunately not God. Horoscopes, whether viewed innocently or not, shape your view of who you are, of your future, of your life. Ouija boards, whether played innocently or not, shape your view of yourself, of your future, of your life. Fortune tellers, palm readers, psychics, they shape the view of how you view yourself, of how you view your future, how you view your worth, how you view what is going to happen in your life. You see, that's the danger of occult practices. They make predictions that you want to hang on to, that you remember, that you put your trust in, that you put some faith in. And those predictions tend to shape you. They shape the view of yourself, your family, or whatever they end up predicting. But God says, I'm a jealous God. I am the one who wants to shape your future. I am the one who tells you your self-worth. God is the master of your life, and he wants to be the master of your life completely. And Jesus says, you know, you can't serve two masters. You either love the one or hate the other, or vice versa. You either look to God for your future, for your worth, for how you view yourself, or you'll look to the occult. You can't share the two. And God will not share you. God will not share you with a false idol. And that's what happened to King Saul. And that's why it's so important. He tried to serve two masters. He tried serving God, but then when things got uncomfortable, when things felt a little bit threatened, he kind of put God on the shelf for a moment to try something else. Maybe this will work instead, he might have thought. Now, this incident in 1 Samuel 28 was the first time that he had appealed to the occult, at least the first time in Scripture. But his attitude had been the problem all along. His heart had been bent in this direction of never fully trusting or putting faith in God. And at its heart, both rebellion and divination are rejections of God's authority in our lives. God hates these things, the occult. Because if you're accepting the occult, you are rejecting him. You're rejecting trust. You're rejecting faith. And you know, if this isn't reason enough for you, there's another reason that God hates the occult, because it can invite demonic things into your life, demonic activity, like we kind of touched on last week. And I really cannot say it emphatically enough, the occult and all that comes with it, whether it's astrology or horoscopes or fortune telling or paranormal activity or the love of it, witchcraft, psychics, mediums, etc., 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 it's not all fun and games. Some of it can actually be real. Some of it actually has power. And we as Christians need to be on the lookout for that kind of stuff and flee from it. Even these so-called toys that you can probably pick up at Walmart and buy for our children are dangerous terrain. We've mentioned Ouija boards. There's things like crystals, the magic lucky eight balls, lucky rabbit's feet. We've all had those things. Some of us have. I've had some of those. And the list could go on and on and on. So that stuff's really no joke. It's dangerous terrain. As innocent as it might seem, oh, Will, calm down. They're entry points in your life for manipulation, for putting your faith and trust in whatever this object might be. And that's all we need, an invitation to distrust God a little bit and put our trust in some plastic. And the reason I felt pushed initially to begin this sermon series is because we as Christians, we do not have our guards up enough. From just viewing social media, listening to conversations, watching here and there, reading certain things, we do not have our guard up enough as Christians. We are letting the Trojan horse ride right on through the gates, and we're opening them. Focus on the Family once posted on their website. Quote, "Anytime the dark side of the supernatural world is presented as harmless or even imaginary, there is the danger that children will become curious and find too late that what they are doing is neither harmless nor imaginary. In a culture with an obvious trend towards witchcraft and New Age ideology, parents need to consider the effect that these ideas have on young and impressionable minds." And it's true for children, but it's also true for adults. You must understand that viewing the occult as innocent or just a toy or just a game or just a newspaper article, that's dangerous terrain in and of itself. It's not innocent. Although these practices are sometimes done just for fun or performed by swindlers for an easy buck, the ability to know things, the ability to actually know future events, is something within the possibility of a demon. They do have power to an extent in the spiritual realm. And this is something we don't often study or explore. But it's certainly something not to take lightly. Seances, channelings, other spirit medium activities are serious matters, dangerous terrain. There are people who are literally talking to someone, literally talking to something that does actually exist. But it's not your dead grandma. They're working with forces beyond that. Earlier this week, I contacted Dr. Jack Cottrell, a longtime professor at Cincinnati Bible Seminary, and asked him about the abilities of demons, biblically, through occult practices. And he had told me this story years ago and retold it to me, and I wanted to share it with you. A preacher friend of his, and we'll just call him Lou, he kept it anonymous, was on a mission trip to India. And on the street one day, a withered old man kind of walked up to him and said, "I can tell you what you're thinking." In other words, "I can read your mind." Now Lou thought he was either just crazy or a complete phony, and just thought he would play with the guy a little bit, test him. So he thought about something embedded in American culture, something that this Indian man would not know. So he closed his eyes, "Okay, yeah, whatever. Tell me what I'm thinking." The little man kind of grinned an evil grin and said, "Mary had a little lamb. Fleece was white as snow." And this was exactly what Lou was thinking, was singing in his head. But before Lou could respond, the man kind of looked him in the eye creepily and said, "Would you like to know the day you're going to die?" Lou, scared and unnerved, quickly turned and walked away. This was real. This true account is just one of many accounts out there that display the power of the spiritual realm, of demons, and the ability for them to actually know what you're thinking and to actually influence the way some think if you allow the invitation. And to use power through victims they have selected. When we think of the occult, you have to think of it as a reality. But it's divided into three real categories: occult knowledge, occult power, and spiritism. And that really just combines power and knowledge. The story is an illustration of occult knowledge, the ability to know, and an illustration of dangerous terrain and these practices that are involved in them. As Christians, we have to do what Lou did and get out of there. We need to flee. We have to flee from these behaviors, this activity. We need to separate ourselves, even if it makes us look goofy, from our families and our friends and those who say, "Oh man, you're just overreacting. You're crazy. We need to seek righteousness. We need to seek holiness. We need to place our full trust and faith in Jesus Christ, not this silly yet real activity. Let's close this morning with Paul's words to Timothy concerning the persistence that we should strive for in our faith. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 through 16 says, "Have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Rather, train yourselves for godliness. For while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance. For to this end we toil and strive, because we have our hope set on the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially of those who believe. Command and teach these things. Let no one despise you for your youth, but set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation, to teaching. Do not neglect the gift you have, which was given to you by prophecy when the council of elders laid their hands on you. Practice these things. Immerse yourself in them so that all may see your progress. Keep a close watch on yourself and on the teaching. Persist in this, for by doing so, you will save both yourself and your hearers." If this morning you've decided to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, to be baptized for the forgiveness of sins and receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, and then live on persistent in your all-out faith in Jesus Christ, if that's your decision this morning, I ask you to please come forward now. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we worship you. We thank you so much for your word, for the truth that it speaks into our lives. Father, help us to rid ourselves of the things that we do that draw us away from you. Let us seek after you. Let us seek after righteousness and holiness. Let us build daily upon our relationship that we have, our trust, our faith built on you. Father, we are surrounded by a culture that opposes you. So, Father, give us the strength each day. Guide our footsteps. Guide our eyes as we attempt to maneuver through the garbage and the sin that so easily surrounds us. Father, we love you. We thank you so much for our Savior, Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.